Let's continue our conversation now with our callers at 1-800-5800-TOM. Catherine on the Tom Likas Show. Hello.
Hey, Tom. How are you?
I'm doing okay.
Hey, Kay. I have to say thank you, first of all, for that bit of research. That was really great in compiling all that information. I'm a researcher myself, and I think that's a really brilliant work that you put together. But I have to side with Tom. I obviously think that there's a lot missing in the marriage paradigm right now. It's not serving society well as a whole, and it needs to be redone or just put to the side like most men have figured out right now. You know, I'm a successful woman at 25. I'm in an open relationship with someone who agrees a lot with what Tom has to say, and it's been wonderful. It's much better than the pre-marriage relationships that most people wanted to have with me in my early 20s, and I think that a lot is being said about going into marriage and popping out kids in a society where there's way too many kids already.
Well, there are not way too many kids. We have a society that's actually going to have a real, what they call, a demographic disequilibrium. That is, we're going to have far too few workers to sustain the kind of life that people expect now for retirees and so on and so forth. And so I think there's a real question about your assumption that there are not enough kids. But aside from that, I think one of the things that maybe I should lay out on the table is I do most of my writing, or a lot of my writing, about marriage. It's a key interest of mine. And I do think that there is, you know, as you say, Catherine, there is something problematic about the marriage paradigm for a lot of people now. And I think one of those things is that we expect too much. The kind of companionship that Tom wants, for instance, from a woman should not be in the form of marriage. I think marriage's primary purpose is to provide a consistent male figure for children. It's lost that purpose because we try to make it mean so many other things. So I would agree with you that, you know, I don't think marriage is for everybody, but I do think it is for people who want to have kids. All of the research that I've looked at suggests that it is a better arrangement for children and for the next generation, and that's kind of a basic assumption from where I'm coming from.
Well, all right there. I could continue to argue against that, but I think I'll let the other callers take a whack at it, too.
All right, Catherine.
Thanks, Tom.
Thank you. Appreciate the call. I noticed no mention of race in your piece that I recall, and your piece really struck me as being about Caucasian men and Caucasian women. Let's take a look at African-Americans for a second. Two-thirds of all births in the African-American community are out of wedlock.
Right. Actually, I do mention race in the very, very beginning. I am talking about white guys and white middle-class guys. Because you're quite right, there are racial disparities here. About 70% of children, of black children today are born to unmarried mothers. The large majority of those children will have either inconsistent or negligible relationships with their fathers. We simply do not know a way to provide close relationships between fathers and children without the institution of marriage. It's never happened. As far as I can see, it will never happen. If you want to have a close relationship with your children, you will stay married as much as is possible. You will marry and stay married to their mother.
Of course, look around. The role models, women that women look up to in this society are the women who say, I'm going to go to Africa and adopt, or I'm going to have children whether I'm married or not, because who needs a man? Who needs a father?
Well, those numbers are still very, very small, Tom. You know, Catherine referred to my research before, and these are numbers that I'm, looked at fairly carefully. The vast majority of women who are having children without being married are low income. From my understanding of what's happening there, they are really limiting the life chances of their children by doing that. And they are not providing men with any role to play, in any strong social role to play. So I think that's very problematic. The women you're talking about, the ones that are going to Africa to adopt children, by the way, I have no problem with that. Those are children who need homes. And I think whoever wants to adopt them, whatever decent person wants to adopt them, it's fine. But the people who are actually creating children, we do know that the relationships that those kids will have with their fathers is very, very complicated by the lack of marriage.
Yes. And, of course, the laws allow women to, or at least the judges allow women frequently to skip town, move to another state with the kid, collect child support checks without ever reporting their whereabouts.
Yeah.
I mean, if you go to one of these websites of these male rights organizations, which you may find distasteful, you will see countless stories of men who are pouring tens of thousands of dollars of money they've earned into lawyers and child support checks and attempts to find the kids through private investigators, what have you. And women are given wide berth to just disappear with the kid and never be seen again and just collect that cash.
I think that is a terrible problem, and I'm well aware of the misery of men who have been left or feel that they've been left and whose children have been taken away from them, and I think it is a tragedy. And,
it doesn't make it very appealing to take that kind of risk.
Yeah. Well, you know, you said that before, and I wanted to ask you, you've been divorced at least twice, from what I gather.
Four times.
So you have developed a certain, through experience, certain ideas about what's possible in the
What's possible and what marriage really is,
which is
a contractual arrangement in which you form a corporation with somebody that is approved by the Secretary of State of your state with the raised seal of the Secretary of State that's placed on there before that marriage certificate is returned to you after you get married, in which you are agreeing to put in half of everything you earn, which for stay-at-home moms is frequently nothing or negligible. And then at the end of things don't work out, mom can simply open the vault and take half or more of everything a man has earned.
Well, let me get back to my point, which is that I don't think that young men in their 20s and probably even in their early 30s who have never been married are thinking the way you're describing.
I don't agree, and I got to tell you why. Okay. I've been doing this show in this form now for 11 years, and we've been talking about these issues with young men every day for hours. They do think about that because we have the first generation of adult men who are raised by single mothers.
Yeah.
They've seen divorce. Yeah. Even though they may not have been married themselves or may not have the bitterness of past experience by getting married, they have seen what divorce is all about. This is why the median age of marriage for men continues to go up. It's because they have been victims of divorce as children.
Yeah. No, I think you're right about one thing. That is that the divorce culture that started in the late 60s and really took off in the 70s has been very damaging to young people's feelings and about the possibilities of marriage. However, statistically, the children of divorce are, though they are more likely to divorce themselves, they often don't tend to avoid marriage. They often marry actually rather early. I think I would guess because they're hoping to provide for themselves what their parents have taken away, that is a stable family.
And what are the divorce statistics for people who marry young?
Oh, they're high. You know, it depends what you mean by young.
80%?
No. Oh, no. Well, it depends what you mean.
If you get married before age 21.
Well, yes, before 21. But by the time you get to about 25, those rates don't seem to differ that much from somebody at 30 or 35.
Right. And 25 is an age that I give men. I say, if you insist on getting married, why get married before 25? Why even have a serious relationship before age 25?
I think that marriage before 25 is a little bit risky. Depends on the kid, you know, and for my kid, I'd be sort of wondering and a little worried about it. But, you know, what happens, I think, is once you get past 25 and the years go on and on and on, and you're in and out of serial relationships, you have gone through many breakups, you've experienced a lot of the bitterness of a kind of divorce in many cases, because, you know, many, many young people have multi-year relationships that are fairly serious, but for various reasons they break up. I think that adds to a sense of bitterness and a lack of confidence about the future that really is very damaging to marriage.
I just happen to believe that people should have confidence in themselves. They should feel good about living alone. They should feel good about being with themselves. And they should feel good about having a home that is theirs, where they don't get told not to put their feet up, or they can't watch football, they can't have a flat screen in the living room, or all the various things that men are getting tired of being told.
Well, you know, I don't agree. I think that we are social creatures. We want that kind of stability. We want those kinds of stable, long-term relationships. Human beings have always desired those things, sought ways to define themselves through their relationships, through their families, and I just don't think that will ever go away.
All right, we'll see what the public thinks as we continue our conversation with Kay Heimowitz. She is contributing editor to City Journal.